amazing how this world was made. I wonder if God is a woman. The gift of life astounds me to this day. I give it up for the woman. She's the constant wind that fills my sail. Oh, that woman. With a smile and a star, she'll protect you like a child. That's a woman. She'll put a smile upon.
For complex set of issues and debates surrounding primary education, secondary and tertiary, and health education in particular. For girls and women, denying the girl access to education implies making her a dysfunctional member of the society. In Africa, women are considered as men's properties or pleasure objects. They are also considered as a machine for producing children. These situations have resulted in unfair treatment of women, especially with regards to education of the male child than the female child. It is upon this backdrop that we decide to unveil certain issues rocking the training and education of male child in the society, with a much deeper concentration on insecurity and the future of the male child education in Nigeria. Sit tight as more programs unveil to this event.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. I want to welcome you all to this event. My name is Ojoma Ukwela, and once again, I want to welcome everybody to this event. It is the International World Women Day, and you know, especially for Nigeria, for so many years, we have seen the marginalization of women in terms of what they are supposed to do and how they are supposed to act. But you know, hopefully, events like this can come around and begin to change the systems and the perceptions that actually we put to note on this thing. So, it's with great pleasure that I actually bring you greetings from Lim Consult. My name is, once again, my name is Ojoma Ukwela. I want to say we are thankful and we are privileged to actually be hosted by the Federal University of Lafia. Our students. Oh, okay, we got all students. Okay, great Nigerian students.
Great.
Great Nigerian students.
Great.
Great Nigerian students.
Great.
Okay, thank you so very much. I want to welcome all the professors. Thank you so very much. Professor Dugga, thank you so very much for hosting this event. And all our lecturers and all our speakers, thank you for hosting this event. Very quickly, I will just bring to you the description of our partners. Now, one of our partners that is working with us is people that we call this Page Initiative. Page Initiative. Page Initiative is Participatory Communication for Gender Development Initiative. It's a non-profit, non-governmental organization based and registered in Nigeria. Our mission is to foster inclusiveness and equity in every aspect of life in Nigeria. Promote participatory communication in the society by ensuring that marginalized groups are understood and empowered, and that women and men are encouraged to work together towards achieving parity for all. Page Initiative has achieved this using participatory learning tools and by creating a platform, especially through the use of the media, where gender dynamics are addressed adequately. Now, apart from Page Initiative, we are directly also being partnered by the Lim Consult, which I come from. So, learning adolescent issues for better mentorship expectations, Lim Consult is an indigenous non-governmental organization fully committed to positively impacting the adolescent and the young ones from low-middle-income countries. Now, our focus is actually dealing with the adolescent and looking at the issues that actually mitigate against them. We look at the things that people don't usually address when it comes to adolescent issues and youth at large. We focus on supporting the African youth with concentrated mentorship and focused learning to explore ideas, innovations, and content that the average African adolescent can use to impact the socio-economic context. Most dominant among the adolescent group, and the issues that mitigate their growth and contributions to development, such as governance, GBV, HIV, sexual and reproductive health. Now, these things are actually achieved through scholarship. We try to get financing health initiatives that can last long, so that you know we can impact the youth more. And we support you innovative and sustainable health financing initiatives, research, coaching and mentorship to give the average youth a platform and a better future. We are nurturing Africa's future by utilizing all channels of advocacy and developmental strategies. Now, and I believe with this partnership and more partner events with the federal university, the youth at large, the adolescent at large, I know that we can make great statement like what we are doing today. It is the International Women's Day, the day to project in women, the day to explain and understand how women are powerful and how much they can contribute to the socio-economic context. And it is in, now it's not just about the women asking for it, it is the society asking for it. We are saying that as a society we need to be better and do better when treating women. We need to do better and so that our future can be better. Thank you so very much for us all of the day. Have a lovely evening.
Invited speakers to this event, colleagues, and our dear students, good morning. Today is International Women's Day. And I want us to stand up and give a 1 minute ovation for the women of the world, if you will join me. Thank you very much. You may be seated. Last week I got a message on WhatsApp and it was a postcard that was colorfully painted. And it was painted by a little boy whose father used to beat his mother. And when the boy asked him why he was beating his mother, the father told him it is because she sits at home all day and does nothing. And when I come back from work, she disturbs my life. So the boy took up his paintbrushes and painted all the things his mother does from morning till night. And there were about 12 pictures of his mother doing different things, which, as far as the husband is concerned, does not or do not amount to work. And I said we should clap for the women, because many times what women do is underappreciated or not appreciated at all. That's why we don't have an International Men's Day, as it were, but we have an International Women's Day, so that we can focus on the women of the world. And I'm happy that TMA 316, Theatre for Development, as a course in the first semester, is collaborating with some NGOs to highlight the issues of women, particularly this year, on insecurity and the future of girl child education in Nigeria. There's no doubt Nigeria is going through a very difficult time, security-wise. It is difficult for the soldiers. It is difficult for the police. It's difficult for all the security forces. It's difficult for men. It's difficult for women. It's difficult for children. But in looking at the International Women's Day, the focus on the girl child is even more dire than everyone else in the society. Recently, there have been on the news, female students have been kidnapped, right? I don't know if you've been following, if you've been doing a count, but part of scholarship now is to do some statistical analysis. I think 4 schools have been raided by bandits or Boko Haram and so on. And I think it was only one of them that was a boys' school. The others were girls' school. So the question is, why are girls' schools always targeted? Why are bandits and insurgents always targeting the girls? But more than that, what can we do to protect the girl child and ensure that she schools in a secure environment? As a father of 3 girls, I think it would be very difficult for me to send my daughters to a school where I know they will be vulnerable. But not sending them to school, I am making them even more vulnerable for life. And I think this is why this is so important for us to discuss today. The panel that has been gathered is very adequate, and I'm sure they will tackle these issues from various dimensions. And I know that our students have various artistic expressions that will help us reflect on this matter. The idea is go beyond this Faculty of Arts auditorium. Let's send the message out. The girl child is a danger and needs to be protected. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alan, distinguished Professor Victor Dugga. Indeed, girls and our women need to be protected from vulnerable factors. I also like to welcome some of the lecturers that stepped in. An immediate past head of department. She has attended several national and international conferences and has published in both national and international journals and books, such as Kaduna Journal of Humanities, Calabar Historical Journal, International Journal of Development Studies, Historical Research Letters, Women and Nigeria Biafra War, Nigeria's Resource Wars, International Journal of Humanities Theoreticals, and many others. She has interest in social, history, and gender studies. Please can we give her a round of applause once again for our colleague, Associate Professor Zara Emmanuel Kwaghe.
The Dean, Faculty of Arts, the HOD, Theatre and Media Arts, the lecturers present, and my amiable students, welcome to Women International Women's Day. Let's clap. Let's clap. You are all welcome to International Women's Day. Today, like the Dean said, we are going to look at some aspects that has to do with our girls in relation to their education. The future of the girls' education. What is the future of our girls? With the insecurity that we are experiencing every day, what will be our girls' future? So the title of my presentation this morning is Insecurity and the Future of Girls' Education in Nigeria. We know that before development goal is quality education for every child, particularly girls, by the year 2030. It was one of the goals for the 2015 development goals. But because we were not able to reach it, it was passed to the sustainable development goals. And the question today is, have we been able to reach it? And if we have not, what are things we are, what are we doing to reach that particular goal? We know that by April 2020, that is close to about 1.6 million children and youth were out of school in the world. Out of this 1.6 million, Nigeria has the highest number of out of school children. A survey conducted by the United Nations Fund, UNICEF, indicates that the population of out of school children in Nigeria has risen from 10.5 million to 13.2 million, making it the highest in the world. Majority of these children are in the northern part of Nigeria, where insecurities have ravaged academic activities. We know also that Nigeria is not the only nation in the world experiencing insecurity. The world is plagued today with insecurity challenges, which has affected all facets of life. People's freedom is threatened, social and economic abilities are limited, fear and threat has become part of our daily living. People are no longer secure in the environment due to frequent insurgency, terrorism, banditry, kidnapping, hunger, violence, murder, proliferation of small arms and light weapons, and many others. There is virtually no nation in the world today that is free from insecurity. And we see it happening every day in Afghanistan. Today it's not Afghanistan, it's Iraq. If it's not Iraq, it's maybe Indonesia. It's happening all over the world. And you see that while the developed world are worried by the development and deployment of weapons of mass destruction as they cannot completely prevent or protect themselves against biological or chemical weapons, the third world countries are riddled with the problem of proliferation of small arms and light weapons. And those small arms and light weapons are what they are using today to fuel insecurity in Nigeria. So we see in Nigeria the use of small arms and light weapons by Boko Haram, ISWAP, that is Islamic State, West Africa province, the Niger Delta militants, Fulani herdsmen, bandits, kidnappers, robbers, etc., have contributed greatly to the insecurity problem that we are facing in the country. So as a result of the activities of these people, we see that many families have lost their loved ones. People once with homes are rendered homeless. We have so many IDPs scattered all over the country. And girls and women kidnapped and raped. Huge chunks of everything and anything that would be a threat to peace, progress, development, and tranquility within a society. However, for the purpose of this paper, security is defined as insurance of well-being of individuals, groups or nations. It implies freedom or isolation from violence, injustice, deprivation, hunger, or absolute want, which include the capacity of the nation to guarantee its food needs. Thus, from the above definition, we see that security is not merely the state of being free from danger and threat, but also the assurance of the basic necessities of life, such as food, employment, education, shelter, and clothing. So the mistake we are making today is to equate insecurity to just external threat and aggression. But security is beyond that, because people need to know that they have food security, they have also clothing security, they have education security, they have security, all around security. Because when you do that, that is when you know that you are secure in your own country. I know that we are seated today. We are all afraid of what is going to happen next because Today it is that somebody is traveling and is kidnapped. Tomorrow it is that some people came and took away some people. So people are living in perpetual fear. This is what is insecurity is all about. It is the inability of a nation to state, nation state, to protect its citizens from internal and external aggression, pursue and promote their welfare in an environment free from hostility. This has been the case of Nigeria over time. The inability of the ruling class to provide good governance for the citizens over the years ensure conflict and security, insecurity among Nigerians. So today, the state of insecurity in Nigeria is no longer news, and this can only be based on some of the factors or some factors that have been left unchecked for a long time by both the government and the citizens. So those factors are the ones that led to what we are today and where we are today. So the other concept to be defined is girls. Who are these girls? Girls, we know, are biological female offspring from birth to 18 years of age. This period covers the formative years of the girl child. So at this age, female child is totally under the care of parents or guardians or older siblings. So it is at this period that they are exposed to basic necessities and basic needs of life. And it is also the period that they are exposed to formal and informal education. So you see that this is the formative years of the girl child. So this period is very crucial in the life of the female child because they are also vulnerable, like our team already said. It is the age of vulnerability. So anything can happen to them at that time. It's the time that as they are growing, if they are not well guided, surely it will be a period where they will fail to understand some certain things and also fail to progress in life. And we have seen that this is the period in Nigeria where these girls, like Dean already said, are being kidnapped. Anyway, we know of so many of them today that are not back to their parents to be able to live at that formative period of their life. And you can imagine by the time they come back, what will happen? They have grown, they have experienced so many things that will eventually become traumatic in their lives as they grow. As they keep growing, if they are introduced into the society, it will be very, very hard for them to grow with what is happening in society because of what they have experienced. And you know, the cycle continues because this girl will eventually give back to children that will not be giving good education, and they will not also be giving good life because lashes, wars, and many others has contributed in depriving so many girls from acquiring formal education in Nigeria. Girls are usually even forced to drop out of school to help fend for the rest of the family in the rest of in the face of poverty. Of course, we know that girls suffer more in the families. If there is an issue of poverty where they have to make priority as to who should go to school, should it be the boy child or the girl child, they will tend to tell the girl child to draw. So the girl child can go and fend for what the money that will be used to train the boy child. What sin has the girl child committed? What sin? So they are also the worst hit during armed conflicts and insurgencies, terrorism or war, like Dean rightly pointed out. They are forced out of their homes, who suffer and sexual violence, harassment and intimidation. He asked a question, and the question he asked was, why is it that the girl child is the one that is always kidnapped? Why should it be their school? Why? Because the girls are taken, they are forced into a life that they are not ready for. They are made to become women overnight, and they are made to now service those people that have taken them in different ways. So in this type of situation and environment, going to school is often risky and particularly impossible for the girl child. So even though the education of girls has been attacked worldwide from different perspectives, that of Nigeria seems to be more frequent. So since the advent of Boko Haram in the Northeast, we see that it is something that has been occurring. The very first time that we saw it occur was when the Chibok girls were taken on April 2, 2014. After that, it became a common thing, a common phenomenon for us to be experiencing all the time. We saw the Dachi girls taken, and we know that some of the Boko Haram, the Chibok girls are still there. They are not yet out. So we see that happening all the time. Constant abduction of girls by government and insurgents do not allow them to go to school. Of course, truncate their education. So what is the future of this girl child? What's the way forward? It is pertinent to know that the action of abducting these girls deprives them of their fundamental right to education, and if not arrested, it would continue to deepen the already existing gap in education between the north and the rest of the country. Like 2016-2018, because of Kwaghe shows that or reveals that students securing minimum grade from the best admission in West Africa and the northern part was very, very low, and girls were also affected. So what is the way forward? In order to ensure that girls' education, especially in the northern part of Nigeria, thrives, conducive atmosphere must be provided to encourage the enrollment and completion of girls in secondary and primary school, and for spirit not to withdraw them because of the constant harassment. And all schools should not be left without security, because it is now pertinent for schools to be provided with security men, even though it's not very palatable, but for them to be there to help the students when such things occur. And I have also proposed that identity cards should be made for these students, so that special ones, so that they can be identified when they come to school, and that terrorists will not be able to easily clone such identity cards. And also, it is important that girls should learn to train themselves physically. What do I mean? Like even some of our girls that are here, you know, they say girls are weak, vulnerable, and all. What are we doing to help train ourselves so that we don't fall victim, or when we even fall victim, how we can try to free ourselves from our abductors? Sometimes just when we learn to maybe train ourselves on besides the physical health, like karate, like judo, like taekwondo, and all those things. It will help you.
Protect women and young girls.
Thank you. because the woman is in the center of all these things. The woman is the mother, the wife, to the bandits, to the kidnappers, to the rapists, as well as the mother to the victims of these circumstances. What do you think we should do? Should we continue to sit and watch? I don't think so. What do you think?
Production, gender empowerment, and health communication, for which she was awarded NAUJ Media Personality of the Year 2013. She has a PhD degree in mass communication, currently a lecturer in theater and media arts, Federal University of Lafia, Nasarawa State, Nigeria. She is an entertainment educator, quite a number of academic publications to her credit, married to Prof. Ukwela. Her name is Dr. Ojoma Ukwela.
Zara Emmanuel Kwaghe, distinguished lecturers in this department, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to thank God for this day that we have to talk, just a little talk about the female gender and insecurity in an era of one future. Once upon a time, I was in an auditorium with my senior friend, Professor Dugga, in Unit Jaws in 1989 or so. And late Olawo Timi was brought to speak to us. I know late Olawo Timi was a short man, no, a tall man, but very petite. So he came in with the university management and everyone was like, well, we're expecting a giant. They introduced a name person. I went over. The VC was a bit embarrassed. Then Professor Olari Timi stood up and started. Everyone went dead. They wanted to listen to what he was saying. Then he said, okay, now can we start? Fine boys. I wouldn't like to do that kind of drama to the head. Neither would I want us to do that for anyone. The matter of security, insecurity, banditry, women and children is a very, very pathetic matter. It is a very, very touching situation. It is a situation that causes generational harm. The first speaker has done a bit of my work. She laid a foundation for what we should know as security, or insecurity. Jeong Soo talked about the girl child. If you move the slide, we can scroll to where you find my talk about who a female gender is. The female is related to a woman or a girl child. A distinguished individual that has a capability to produce eggs and bring forth offspring. I'd like to move to the next slide so that I can quickly state why is insecurity particularly dangerous for the female when the dean spoke. He said, out of 4 schools that were raided, 3 were female schools. Why? That poster came in the drama, that poster came in the little talk, and it is still a poster we are going to leave this world with. The question is, why women? Why? If you look at banditry, it was also explained. It's a type of organized crime. It's committed by outlaws, typically involving threats or use of violence. And the list of such crimes are endless. Extortion, robbery, guns, terrorism, and it will go a long way. It will go a long way. So, for instance, those who were abducted in school, are they forever damaged or not? I want to hear a response. Yeah. Are they forever damaged or not? Yeah. They are. And we are left with that generational problem. Yes. Can I have the next? Sorry. The question of are women more affected by insecurity is yes. I just established that. It is yes. You will soon see what I'm talking about. When you pass streets or towns, is there anywhere in Nigeria that we don't have cases of insecurity and the ripple effect? You will see where there is an IDP camp. And you will see how the women and their children are living. The man can just hide at the corner, maybe doze off, or maybe hide behind a small bottle of alcohol or something. But the woman cannot do that. She has her children to worry about. In that case, well, at first, 2010, identified that men and women experience different types of security events. Put differently, men and women react to security issues differently. It's understandable, I just said so. Even by the mere physiology of a woman, she cannot be in the same way with a man. And I drove to town this morning. There's this celebration of the International Women's Day as done on the road, FRCN. And one of the music they played was, it is a woman that would leave her family and join the man, even though my own Bible that I believe says it's the man that should lead. But in the African context also, is it African context or the world context now? It is the woman that does the living and leaving, though the Bible says it's the man that should leave, The woman leaves, her family drops her name, because if you call me Dr. Comfort or Nando now, people will say they don't know her, except Prof. Dugga, who knows her. And that. Sorry, I keep referring to. Come on, so, the woman leaves her home, the woman leaves her family, the woman joins the man, the woman adopts another family, the woman again loses her shape so that she can raise offspring, isn't it? Yet, when she's done, it's the same woman that goes to the labor. Thank you. It is the same woman that goes to the
to all kinds. Why? Is it like a sin to be a woman? Is the world telling us that the men no longer need women? In the original history, we knew that God said it is not good for the man to be alone. That's why he made a woman. Why are men making women look like they are not supposed to exist? Go to the next before I turn to become an advocate. The next slide. Rome, I already established marriage. If you look anywhere in Nigeria, there is nowhere that you cannot see the handwork of bandits and banditry, tax-crossing, kidnapping, all kinds. And we are not treated with this. We are. It is getting to a boiling point. Do I need to say the result? Increased number of internally displaced persons and refugee problems. If you pass through from Mapuki to before you get to the water or Kaduku, you know how many camps you will meet. How many camps displaced, internally displaced, living in very, very dehumanizing conditions? And why would you be able to wind down your car on the way as you're coming? The fumes from the roadside open toilet, there are more crimes. Why would there be more crimes? Because who wants to eat and they don't have it? Now, I don't know whether we can say this, but I tried to snap one IDP camp. This one is located in North Bank of Middle State, North Bank of Matthew Middle State. I don't know if you can see it clearly, I'm not sure if you see it. But in between those buildings are some shanties there. So what they did is to make sheds, very small, small sheds, like the ones the Fulani people used to keep their cows on. And then all of them, they squeeze in there, the children are there, the women are there, they are cooking there, they are sleeping there, they are sleeping there. If you see the rail, we're not even transporting the rail, that is the highway. And people stand straight in there, and their lives are not safe. They are in the open air, under direct sunlight, and this is the situation we find ourselves in Nigeria. We don't want to belabor the point. We know very well that if we look at the history of wars and insecurity everywhere, what triggered the First World War, if I can have that slide, was what? Domination of one tribe by the other, people going to harass people, and then resort them into wars. First World War, isn't it? The casualty rate was put at 8.5 million soldiers and 13 million civilians. Out of these 13 million civilians, ladies and gentlemen, women and children will be born. The Second World War started. How did it begin? The global pandemic, the heated international political climate, states of banditry, rape, catastrophe, economic, for financial abduction, all the sexual violence, killings, murder, government international and generalized insecurity. Is it that we are already in the Third World War without knowing? And if this is another war, as I watched President Buhari say the other day, where is Zamora, elsewhere, the school, Zamora was created, he said schools should provide security for their students, school managers. So how much security, for instance, would you put around your school? So be sure that you have enough. So, in 2020, he was quoting out of esteem. He said, I know not with what weapons fall before I am killed. So she went to order for gun. If it is becoming a state of anarchy, where no one
a woman is not safe at home or at work, then everyone, even the men too, are not safe. Recently, a very big man was just killed. They went to his house and killed him. Somebody was abducted, and when he was narrating his experience, he said, security could not help him. That they took him. And they were probably scared, and they took him.
So if it is coming to that point where no one is safe anywhere, perhaps the solution will lie in the hands of women and their children to gather and reenact the Abah Women Rights of 1929. What happened then, historians will tell us. When situations went out of hand, women went out naked. And when they went out naked and marched to the offices of the power that be, the men had to listen. So if women and their children decide that they will each take stick and stone and move around the streets of our world, stone every bandit, maybe we'll be able to sleep with our eyes closed. What it means is that the time has come for us to educate the women and their children on the need to stand up for their own defense. To be strong. Professor Zara said people should learn karate. I buy it. Learn fighting tactics. Go with shots. Anything that can help you defend yourself. That may be the stick and that may be the stone to be able to prevent all this act of banditry along, ladies and gentlemen, in prayers, because with God, all things are possible. Thank you.
A woman can be anything if given equal opportunity as men. They said women can't work together. My father is always afraid that I may be kidnapped from school. My uncle feels that women belong to the kitchen and the bedroom. My brother believes that educated women are not submissive. Girls' lives matter. Women count. Every child deserves quality education in a safe environment.
One day in Nigeria, a woman would be
a governor,
a Senate president,
a chief of defense,
our president.
But we cannot get there
if we do not start today.
Protect women and young girls. Nigerian women matter.
Celebrating women. Nigeria as a home's global icons, Chimamanda Adichie, Amina Mohammed, Osisat Oshoala, Nkosi Okojo-Owela, Olulupe Arotile, and so many more. Let's protect women and the girl child.
Nigerian women matter.
Protect women and young girls.
Nigerian women matter.
Protect women and young girls.
Nigerian women matter.
I've heard of learning judo and karate. Should women not join the armed forces? Should women not enlarge their numbers in the Senate? Should women not find legal means of defending themselves? Because those who don't have the opportunity to go to school are looking for those who have gone to school to help them. So how can those who have not had the opportunity be defended by those who have had the opportunity to go to school? Thank you.
Questions for you. I will say my own bit and then my senior sister will say that. Yes, women should be encouraged to join the armed forces. That's where it even begins.
The reason why, for instance, I said, on my own part, I said women should learn the immediate truth that can help them, is because when bandits come, you need to first see if you can move out of the situation before you go to court, before you seek help, before you get any legal things you can get. So women should be encouraged to undertake any trade, any profession that will help. I was just trying to remember the case of the girl child who was raped by family members, and even raped, and she got diseased, and of course she died. She went to the hospital, the case was poorly managed, and she died. It was a celebrated case in Benue, just that the name of the victim is a new name. It was the Ochana case. It was Ochana, the case of Ochana, many of us followed that. It was the migration of female lawyers that went to make sure the culprits were brought to book. Yes, if it is possible to know who the bandits are, why not? It would be their fault. But you see, the nature of banditry is such that the crime is perpetrated, the outlaws disappear. So you go to court to prosecute who? That's what the question is.
Students from this dilemma. And you know, one of the things we'll be doing in the next few weeks is a call for application for volunteer. So for as many people that would love to volunteer, where we can make history like we have done today, where we can, you know, debate on issue and, you know, progress and, you know, project the issues that mitigate against adolescents at youth at large, you know, you can always come around and check our website, lakeconsult.org, and then our social media page at lakeconsult on Instagram. You can get more information and details about this. Once again, I want to thank everybody and the speaker that's like this. Can we welcome Professor James Okwute for the closing remarks? Thank you.
On behalf of the Department of Theatre and Media Arts, I'd like to congratulate all those who have collaborated, the various organizations that have collaborated with our lecturers and students to put this show together in honor of the International Women's Day. And also on behalf of the department, I'd like to congratulate all the women in this room. We give them our sincere appreciation. Please put a hand together for them. It's your day. It's your day.
Nigerian women.